Hello students, I'd like to continue with the online lessons on a regular basis, 2 times a week, as long as this is the only possibility to give your explanation of the topic. I know it's more difficult for you to study on your own and to focus on important details that I need. So today we will continue with the revolution of 1848 in Hungary. So please to study with me, open your books again. So on the page 211, revolution of 1848 in Hungary, you have it just there, and let's go through it together. The revolution of 1848 is connected to the Spring of Nations that we mentioned. This was something like a movement in all of the Europe. So all of European nations were in its springtime. So they wanted to rise as new nations with their new symbols to be distinguished from the other. So it's like birth. Okay, spring is something like that everything is reborn. It's like a fresh start. So spring of the nations hit the Habsburgian monarchy as well. It was in March, so actually during the springtime. Rebellions started to happen in Prague and Vienna because these were centers or the main centers of the monarchy, like the capitals of different parts of the monarchy. The head of the monarchy during that period, during the spring of 1848, was Chancellor Metternich. We already mentioned him during the Congress of Vienna, for example. So the Chancellor, it was something like Prime Minister of the monarchy. Okay, so like the highest person in the constitution part of monarchy. So not king, but basically prime minister, as I said. And he was forced to abdicate during this revolution in 1848 because the liberals led by Lajos Kossuth suggested some constitutional changes. While the liberals are people who believe in different freedoms and they wanted to apply these in the government. Okay, so Lajos Kossuth was leader of the Hungarian liberals. Okay, in the same time there were Slovak liberals and so on. So every country had their own. The Hungarian liberals actually were opposing the Slovak liberals because we know that as these two countries wanted to expand on the sake of the other one. In your book, there are some of these constitutional changes listed. So you have 6 of them written there. First of them is exemption from taxation was to be abolished. So this means that clergy and nobles also had to pay taxes, because until that time, clergy was free from paying taxes. They didn't have to, and as well the nobles. But from now on, they just had to pay the taxes as the ordinary people did. The second one was abolishing of robota, which means basically compulsory work. So like serfdom. Okay, this ended feudalism, because we know that feudalism is basically based on that peasants just have to work on the landowner's property, okay, and they just have their own little field for themselves in exchange for hard work, which was compulsory. This was abolished in 1848. During this revolution, state wanted to compensate the landowners for their loss of workers. Number 3, suffrage was based on property qualification. Suffrage, first of all, what it is? It is right to vote, basically. Okay, so it's like suffrage means volebné právo, right to vote. So it was based on property qualification, point number four, abolition of aviticity. Well, what does the word aviticity mean?
Znamená to slovičko nescudziteľnosť majetku, hlavne myslíme.
Aviticity of property means that during your lifetime you own some property and you can't give your property for your life to somebody else or to sell it. So you just have it in your possession and then it's inherited by it can be inherited by your children. Okay, so like without permission from the king, you basically can't give your properties to someone else. But now this was abolished.
Čiže to zrušenie tej nescudziteľnosti, čiže ten majetok sa vlastne po tomto zrušení mohol presunúť na niekoho iného.
Number 5. Establishing of the state trial courts, which replaced sedrias. Sedrias were the courts where the nobles were the judges, basically. In every region, there was one of these sedrias, so these were like minor courts. So there were new state trial courts that were established. So not only by nobles, but there were new judges and also new rules how to keep the trial running. And the very last one is the freedom of speech, freedom of assembly, and freedom of speech and freedom of assembly were about to be introduced after the revolution.
Či to právo verejného prejavu a právo zhromažďovať sa, právo na snem.
The emperor signed the laws, and these many changes that happened were known as the March laws, because they were passed in March. Okay, so it's the springtime of nation because this happened in March. It all started with the Spring of Nations, which is considered to be rebirth of nations. So they wanted the fresh start, and even more, the revolution in Hungary was started in March. So these laws were also named March laws, and they established, for example, these six constitutional changes. And mostly they were passed thanks to Lajos Kossuth, who led the Hungarian liberals. But an emperor signed these laws. These laws basically meant the end of feudalism, and they also established the constitutional monarchy in Hungary. This meant that it was no longer absolutism, not even enlightened absolutism. It was constitutional monarchy, and the feudalism finally ended. The Hungarian government was after that led by Lajos Batthyány.
Dávajte pozor na to, ako sa to číta. Čo väčšinou, keď máte T a Y, číta sa to ako T, čiže Batthyány.
He was prime minister, and Lajos Kossuth, who led the liberals, he became minister of finances. The main goal of this new government was the industrialization of Hungary, because, you know, the feudal country that was there before was really not really modern. Basically, Maria Theresa and her son were the only ones who actually modernized the country. And during their lifetime, they didn't manage to do so many things in the term of modernization in all of the fields of public life. So this was their main goal, but there was a little problem. And that was that the Hungarian spare hat were not able to leave the idea of the Hungarian unity behind the other nations of Hungary. So they were trying to still pass that unity over the other ideas of the other nations. For example, Slovakia, Croatia and Serbs. Mostly these Slavic nations, as we are, we were creating really a huge part of the monarchy. So probably everything would go better if they wouldn't pass all of the militarization, because actually all of these march laws were also great for us as for Slovaks, but the militarization, not even a little. Logically, these Slavic nations then became opposition to Hungarian movement. In September 1848, Vienna intervened against the Hungarian movement because, you know, the Austrian part started to be really also suspicious that Hungary wants to be just one ruling nation in the monarchy. And they started to intervene into these matters between Hungary and also the other nations as the Slavic nations. The Hungarian parliament was dissolved. Či dissolved, teda rozpustený bol ten parlament, čiže vlastne zakázali im sa zhromaždiť a ďalej o tom diskutovať. And the state of emergency was declared. In the Austrian government, the liberals, so these ones that were led by Lajos Kossuth, were replaced by the conservatives and 18 years old Franz Joseph replaced Ferdinand V. Franz Joseph became the new emperor during these turbulent times, during the revolution, and he was only 18 years old back in these times. So it was not easy task for him to manage to rule the empire. At the beginning of 1849, the Austrian army started an occupation of Hungary. This was because, as I mentioned, the Austria was afraid that Hungary wants to be just the one ruling nation. So after they dissolved the parliament and they started the occupation, they wanted to suppress the rebellion from the Hungarians. The response of the Hungarians was the rejection of the Habsburgs and the independent Hungary. So they rejected the Habsburgs to be the ruling class, the monarchs. The Hungarian Slav supported Vienna in hope for federalization, but the emperor asked the Russian Tsar for intervention. Well, I will stop there and I will explain it to you a little more. So, the Hungarian Slavs. This means, for example, Slovaks, Croats and Serbs. So, for example, Slovaks, because we belong to the Hungarian part of the monarchy. The Czechs, for example, they belong to the Austrian part of the monarchy. Naturally, there's something like a rule that enemy of your enemy is your friend. This means that we misused the conflicts between the Austrians and the Hungarians, and we started to support Vienna in hope that in exchange they will give us some more rights, so we would be able to fight with the Hungarians and to deal with the militarization better. But Emperor Franz Joseph asked the Russian Tsar for intervention because they were part of the Holy Alliance. That was something what was established during the Congress of Vienna to remain the status quo. And the Hungarian rebels were forced to capitulate on 13th of August 1849 in Világos. Világos sa často používa, teraz neviem, či už ste to niekedy zachytili, že dostaneš Világos ako synonymum pre dostaneš bitku. To znamená práve preto, že vlastne Maďari dostali teda veľký výprask od rakúskeho vojska práve pri meste, ktoré sa volá Világos. It stayed as in the language because this revolution was really bloodily suppressed. So it was actually really cruel battle and all of the main leaders were executed. So that's why it's used like that. That you will get Világos if you ask for it and so on. Kossuth and the other representatives were afraid of a very similar destiny as the military leaders, so they emigrated from Hungary to Turkey. And the military dictatorship was established in Hungary because there was the state of emergency and the new emperor really wanted to restore an order. So that's why he started really cruel, he was strict, and he wanted peace to remain in the country, and that's why he established the dictatorship for some time, but just like in the Hungary, so in the Hungarian part of the monarchy. However, the revolution although the revolution was suppressed, the main reforms were maintained. So for example, peasant emancipation, equality under law, so everybody was equal in the term of the law. So it didn't matter when you were in the trial, if you are Slovak, Hungarian, Austrian or whatever, you were equal. And also peasants, they could move anywhere, so the serfdom was basically really abolished. But still, the national question remained unsolved. So this meant that it was said that in the Kingdom of Hungary there is only one Hungarian nation. Totiž to stále je v tom taká otázka, že ten Hungarian neznamená maďarský, znamená uhorský. No maďarský napríklad povieme ako Maďar. Aj Maďari vlastne volajú Maďarsko Maďar Orsák a nie teda Hungary. To hovoríme o Uhorsku. Či stále bol jeden národ uhorský a táto otázka národnostná sa neriešila. So what did the Slovaks do during this period? Well, we know that during the period of 1848-1849, there was the generation of the Štúrs, so the third generation of Slovak National Revival. And Štúr and his colleagues understood that this situation is a huge chance for Slovak to realize their demands. The first national and political program of Slovaks was created in Liptovský Svetý Mikuláš, čiže to je Liptovský Mikuláš, iba vlastne sa používal tento názov aj teda zo Svety. In May 1848, and this was called the Demands of the Slovak Nation, alebo teda Žiadosti národa slovenského. Žiadosti slovenského národa. Dobre, pamätajte si, toto bude dôležité. Budeme ho potom porovnávať aj s inými programami. The Demands of the Slovak Nation, and it requested creation of parliament of the Hungarian nations. So one parliament and every nation of the monarchy will have
its representatives. Čiže uhorských národov. Takže napríklad slovenský národ by mal sám zastúpenie v tomto sneme.
All nations were about to have their own assemblies.
Čiže vlastné zhromaždenie.
We could use the Slovak language in administration and education. So the Slovak language would be one of the languages of the monarchy. Also use of the Slovak symbols. So Slovak flag, coat of arms, Slovak anthem maybe. So really just for the our part, and every nation of the monarchy could use its own.
Creation of the complete educational system. So this means that elementary school, high schools and university as well. Because before there was, for example, there were just few elementary schools, but nothing more. And these elementary schools were mostly based around monasteries and cathedrals, so around religious spheres. Next one, universal suffrage. So this was right to vote. Universal right to vote was based that anyone over the age, for example, of 18 could vote. And it wouldn't matter what is your property, if you're rich, if you're not, if you're Slovak, if you're Hungarian, if you're Serb, okay? So universal suffrage. Next one, freedom of press. So there would be no censorship. You could write anything you want. And the last one is liberation of Jan Kokeral and Jan Rotarides, because these two were arrested. So this was one special demand.
We can say that these demands of the Slovak nation could be divided into national, social, democratic and special demands or requests. And for example, we can say that the national ones could be use of the Slovak symbols, of the Slovak language, and so on. The social would be, for example, about educational system, about creation of our own schools. The democratic ones could be freedom of press, right to vote, suffrage, and the special one would be liberation of Jan Kokeral and Jan Rotarides. This is for the context, okay? So you can tell me that these were national, social, democratic, and one that was special. And that is the last one. Dobre, čiže napíšte si tam prosím vás niekam na bok, že teda national, národné, social, sociálne, democratic, demokratické, and one was special. Prepustenie teda Janka Krála a Jana Rotaridesa. Dobre, aby ste, ja si myslím, že každý mi vie asi povedať, čo znamená národná požiadavka, pokiaľ budete vedieť týchto 8. Okay, we can go on. Demands were ceremoniously declared on 11th May 1848 in Ondrášová. This is really close to the Liptovský Mikuláš. The response of the Hungarian government was very fast, and you can guess it was not really welcomed. So the state of emergency was declared, and an arrest warrant was issued for Stur, Hurban and Hoxha. So for the three main representatives of the Sturs of the third generation. They fled the country and they headed to Prague. So they went for one special event that is called Prague Slavic Congress.
Alebo teda Pražský slovanský zjazd. Napíšte si to kľudne aj nad to, slovanský
zjazd. That happened in Prague. The Prague Slavic Congress was an official assembly of all Slavic nations living in Austria. The main conclusion of the assembly was the will of the Slavic nations to change the regime of the Habsburgian monarchy, because of course they didn't like how it was going. The Federation of Nations of the monarchy was about to be established. The political concept, the Federation of Nations, led by the Habsburg, was called Austroslavism.
Pokiaľ si pamätáte napríklad slovičko panslavizmus z minulého videa, kde som hovorila o tom, že Slováci sa snažili hľadať spojenie všetkých slovanských národov pod Ruskom, čo voláme panslavizmus.
Austroslavizmus opäť voláme, že teda federácia národov, ktorú by viedli Habsburgovci, čiže pod rakúskym zjednotením.
Toto znamená, aby ste mi to vedeli vysvetliť, keď sa opýtam, čo to znamená.
Austroslavizmus. Rakúšania, teda vlastne Habsburgovci, ktorí boli Rakúšania, by mali viesť všetky tieto národy vo federácii. On the 12th of June, the sudden uprising was suppressed by the army of General Windischgratz. You don't need to remember this name. Don't worry. After the incident, the Prague Slavic Congress ended. This was that people who were at the Congress were stopped by this general, and there was some shooting to the people. Actually, just my tip for you, there was something like TV series about the Sturz. It was by the actors of Slovak National Theater. So I know it's not like really amusing, but some of the scenes are on YouTube, so you can just search it up and probably you can remember it better. I used it, for example, for my university exams about this topic, and there is one good scene about this Prague Slavic Congress, so I will just put this video for you, this scene, so you can watch it now.
Štúr si rozumie s Rígom i Havličkom u púta mladého Friča. Spoločné ohrozenie si žiada spoločný postup. Náčelným mužom slovanského zjazdu sa stane František Palacký. Slovo dostane Poliak, Moravan, Slovinec, Čech, Rusín, Slovák. Všetci sa budú dožadovať nastolenia nových poriadkov pre svoje utláčané národy. Vznikajú pracovné sekcie a výbory. Pod Šafárikovým vedením zasadá aj výbor československý.
Hlásime se k Rakouské říši a žádáme konstituční, to jest ústavní vládu s národními zastupitelstvími. Proto jsme tady, abychom takovou vládu měli a pak i stůj, co stůj, bránili.
Proč máme bránit rakouské mocnářství? To se ubrání samo.
Proč?
Proč? Abychom získali národní sněm. Máme to přislíbeno.
A my zas máme smutné zkušenosti s věděnskými slubmi.
Dosť bolo prozieba sľubov. Žiadame, čo nám patrí.
Klid, pánové! Žiadam o klid! Pánové, pán Palacký ešte nedomluv.
Prosím, takhle, pánové, takhle ne. Sme loajální lidé. A vše, co podnikáme, ať zústane v mezích zákona. Jestli ne, je ohroženo i konání našeho sjezdu. Navrhuji, abychom myšlenku o zachování Rakouské říše dodatečně vepsal jako hlavní bod našeho jednání. Jinak nedosáhneme ničeho.
Taká politika nikam nepovedie. Pán predseda, dajte slovo aj iným.
Žiadajme slobodu aj pre uhorských Slovanov.
Žiadajme federalizáciu.
Rovnoprávnosť všem národom.
Lid, prosím. Pánové, žádám o klid. Prosím, pán doktor Frič. V otázce zachování Rakouska sme, pánové, doufám, všichni zajedno. Rozcházíme se, pokud se týče prostředků tohoto cíle.
To myslíte vážně? Naším cílem by malo být zachování Rakouska. Zachovajme seba samých. Najprv služme sebe, potom iným. Doteraz Rakousko stálo a my jsme biedně hynuli. Čo by povedal svět, keby jsme se starali iba o zachování Rakouska? Slovanské krajiny ešte nie sú slobodné. Ba ešte ani samostatné. Len Česi, Moravania a Poliaci užívajú akú takú samostatnosť. Uhorskí Slovania nie. A preto musíme najprv zlomiť uhorské pomery. Zničiť prevahu Maďarstva. Chráňme sa toho, aby sa vláda vrhla do náručia Maďarov. A na druhej strane Nemcov.
Souhlasím s panem Štúrem. Jsou teď v Rakousích národové panující a soudnáří. První jsou Němci a Maďaři, druzí Slovani. Musíme proto na každý pád paralyzovat německou a maďarskou sílu u vlády.
Nebojte sa, Palecký sa vrát.
Není ale možné bez poražení.
Já ho dobře poznám.
Musí buď dobrovolně ustoupit.
Ako si porozumě s jinými, keď se nezhodně znajdečí.
Výbor nakonec upustil od radikálnych Štúrových a Havličkových požiadaviek a prijal miernejšie Palackého a Šafárikové formulácie. Ale podstata zostala. Všetky národy majú byť rovnoprávne.
Krásná slova, ale nic víc.
Nie, naša slovenská vec získava tu v Prahe čoraz väčšie sympatie.
Dovolíte, zoznámte sa. To je František Zach a toto Bedřich Vloudek. Nech sa páči. Obaja majú vojenské skúsenosti a to sa nám môže zísť. Pán Zach sa zúčastnil poľského povstania v 31. Odvtedy žije v emigrácii. A pán Vloudek je bývalý dôstojník.
A k tomu dobre rozumiem, príde riadna hrmavica.
Krvu štečie na Dunaji. Drahá krv junákov srbských. Ľud bezbranný kričí o pomoc. A kto tu má pomáhať? Ak je, bratia. Slováci tiež kričia o pomoc. A bratia majú pomáhať. Košúc smeje sa so Slovákov nešťastných a posmešne ich vyzýva, aby si mečom vydobili práva. Nuž keď meč, tak meč. Pomáhajme všetci bratom Slovákom. Vy, bratia Česi a Moravania, stojíte najbližšie Slovákom. Ste bratia a susedia. Pomáhajte im. Pomôžete tým zároveň nám, bo vrah je spoločný. Sľubujem, že zo strany srbskej zaobstarám pre Slovákov 10 000 zlatých.
Pánové, toto je nové znění manifestu, který předložíme sjezdům. Shromáždění poslové obcí a hlus slovanských celé Rakouské říše se skupují se v jeden spolek na obranu své národnosti. Slované v Uhrách žijící vyjadřují ochotu dohodnout se s maďarskou stranou, jestli ona respektovati bude jejich požadavky. Jestli ne, pak společnou silou zlomí nadvládu Maďarů.
12. júna sa po tzv. Zbratovacej omši konala veľká demonstrácia v Pražanu. Zemský veliteľ, generál Windischgrätz, ju dal rozhodnúť. To bol začiatok povstania a zároveň predčasný koniec zjazdu. Museli sme opustiť Prahu, aby sme sa vyhli zatknúť. Ale kam sme sa mali podieť? Doma nám hrozilo to isté, ak nie ešte väčšie nebezpečenstvo. Mali sme na výber. Mohli sme sa stať Nemcami alebo Maďarmi. Krajan Šafárik nám však kládol na srdce, ak sme schopní národnej a ľudskej slobody, musíme bojovať.
Thank you.
And we will continue with Slovak National Council. After what happened in Prague, Štúr and Hurban went to Croatia, where they negotiated the uprising against the Hungarian government with Croats and Serbs. On 16th of September 1848, the Slovak National Council, led by Štúr, Hurban and Hoxha, always these three, because they were the main representatives. So the Slovak National Council was created in Vienna, and it was the first political institution of the Slovaks ever. The council organized the campaigns of volunteers. The small contingent of rebels crossed the border near Mijava. So they were preparing in the Czech part, because the Czechs were also helping, because they were a Slavic nation as well. So they crossed the borders near Mijava, and after 10 days, the untrained and really badly equipped rebels were defeated. So it took only 10 days for them to rebel until they were suppressed, because these were just volunteers, ordinary people who wanted to fight the Hungarians. This was the first campaign, okay, because there will be more of them. So the first ended in failure, because only after 10 days they were defeated. This failure, at least, led to the cooperation with Vienna in return for national rights. So, we cooperated with Vienna, and together we wanted to defeat the Hungarians in exchange for national rights. Slovaks, led by Austrian officers, realized two campaigns, the winter campaign and summer campaign. Zimná výprava a letná výprava. The situation of the volunteer was quite different. The army was well equipped, and the army had its own uniforms. So this was really different compared to the first campaign. During both of these campaigns, Slovak volunteer army conquered the territory of Slovakia. In March 1849, the Slovak deputation visited Emperor Franz Joseph. He gave them uncertain promises to the Slovak demands they requested for. After the defeat of Hungarian uprising at Világos, the situation was rather different. Slovaks were disarmed and dissolved. The revolution was over for the Hungarians and for the Slovaks as well. Či tu sme sa trochu vrátili. Najskôr sme mali revolúciu v celom Uhorsku, brané z celkového hľadiska, potom sme sa zamerali, akú úlohu v ňom hrali čisto Slováci. Čiže napríklad aj my sme sa zúčastnili toho tzv. Výprasku pri Világoši. Až na to, že sme za to žiadali nejaké ústupky voči našim národným slobodám, ktoré nám nakoniec, aj keď boli prisľúbené, neboli dané. To see how the Slovak Volunteer Army looked like in the first campaign, and later I will also show you a little scene of that TV series Štúrovci. So, let's watch.
Konečne to. Kto dostane zbrane, dá si poradu. Rýchlejšie. Nebolo kedysi hranice medzi Slovenskom a Moravou. Za starých čias to bola spoločná vlast zbratrených slovanských národov. A preto nemá byť ani teraz hranica medzi týmito dvoma krajinami, ktorá by rozdeľovala zbratané kmene. Bojovníci, za tými vrškami, tam leží Slovensko. Naša rodina, národ náš ubiedený, utlačený, 1000 rokov samostatnosti pozbavený. Národ povrheň. Ale ešte nevyhynul národný duch. Naši nepriatelia nás všetkého pozbavili. Lež vôľu nikto dobrať nemôže. A táto vôľa nás vedie zo zbrojov v ruke za tie vršky k nášmu národu. Je to tá cesta, po ktorej ťahli takedy české pluky pod Iskrom, Komorovským a druhými. A ako tí išli boj zatočiť o panstvo s Maďarmi, tak aj my ideme, aby sme pozdvihli národ náš. Aby sa mečom rozhodlo, či bude ešte tyran Maďar panovať nad nami. Rozvili sme už naše zástavy, vidíte ich povievať nad svojimi hlavami. Sľúbte nám, že ich neopustíte v žiadnom boji, v žiadnom nebezpečenstve.
That is it. So just quickly to revision, what you will need to know are the constitutional changes suggested by Lajos Kossuth, who were Lajos Batthyány and Lajos Kossuth, what happened after Franz Joseph was on the throne, so the new monarch. What were the March laws? What was the position of Slovaks in revolution? The demands of the Slovak nation as the first political program of the Slovaks? What was Prague Slavic Congress and what happened there? How the Slovak National Council was formed? And about Slovak Volunteer Army and its free campaigns. You can search up for more information also on the internet. So for example, this page I found is actually really good, so you can find more context in Slovak language as well, because you don't need to study in English actually, because these are like this is Slovak history, so you can find it in Slovak language, and then you can just make some notes in English, because I know that you're actually your language is really good, so that should not be a problem. If there is anything you would like to ask me, you can contact me anytime by email, or you can write me you can leave a comment. And I would like to also have maybe some feedback, and I will continue with these lectures on a regular basis, so you will also get another video this week. That's everything for me, so stay home, stay healthy, and bye.